floating point numbers. If you've programmed, you've probably used these, right? Floating point numbers are numbers that support decimal points. Now, we have an idea of how computers store numbers, hopefully. If you don't, there are video resources that you can refer to. Watch that video first to get an idea of how integers, whole numbers, are being stored by computers. And then come back here and we'll talk about the decimals, alright? You're watching another Random Wednesday episode on 0612 TV. Hello and welcome back to another Random Wednesday episode. Today, let's talk floating point. Clearly, decimal numbers are not that easy to represent. We're going to first very briefly talk about fixed point numbers. You know how when you're working with a normal integer, well, you've got your different bits, and each bit basically represents whether you want to switch on or off a particular power of 2, right? So this combination is going to give you these values that you add together, and that gives you this answer. The easiest way to do decimal numbers is to simply change up those, well, powers of 2 on top. What I can say is, let's assign a decimal point smack in the middle. The left side of the decimal point is where our normal powers of 2 start. On the right side, we have negative powers of 2. Yes, what this means is this is half, this is a quarter, this is an eighth, this is a sixteenth. So yeah, we can do that, right? And you can start to have decimal numbers. But watch what happens. Originally, we could represent 0 to 255 with an unsigned 8-bit number. So we've got a fairly good range. But now, because of how we've sort of, you know, reallocated our bits here, they now represent a much smaller range of numbers, right? Because I essentially only have a 4-bit integer on the left, I only have 0 to 15. And on my right side, this doesn't give me all the decimal numbers that I can possibly represent within this range. For example, if I wanted 2.5, I could do that, right? I'll get 2 on the left side by, you know, doing it the usual way. And if I want 0.5, then the 2 to a power of minus 1 bit will be switched on. That's half. So in that context, it's all well and good. Everything works just fine. But that's just because I chose an example that worked. Let's take a look at some other numbers that will not work with this very simple fixed point scheme. Starting first with something like 16. Well, clearly you can't do that because you only have 4 integer bits. The biggest number you can represent is 15, so there is an overflow in this situation. The same idea actually applies on the decimal portion as well. If you want to represent 2 to the power of negative 5, you're out of luck because there is no such bit. Of course, nothing's stopping us from having both on the same number, right? So you get overflows on both ends. These examples are just simple ones for this particular fixed point representation. For all three of these problems, we could technically attempt to solve it by simply adding more bits. We have 8 bits total here. If we have 16, then of course we have more numbers on each side. However, there is still a great inflexibility. For example, we wouldn't have a problem storing this value if we were able to shift the decimal point somewhere else. In fact, as long as it shifts by just one place, then this will be okay. But unfortunately, these are fixed point numbers, and that doesn't happen. Of course, there are other restrictions at play here as well. For example, if you try to represent 0.2, as a fraction, that's 1 over 5. And there is no possible negative power of 2 that can exactly represent this. Now, this problem runs deep. When we move on to floating point numbers, this problem cannot be solved either. So really, we're just including this here for completeness sake. So, fixed point numbers are a good step towards having decimal numbers, but not quite good enough because most numbers cannot be represented properly. This, ladies and gentlemen, is where the floating point number comes into play. We're gonna now enter the world of 32-bit numbers, alright? So, yeah, every number we're going to talk about from this point on is made up of a total of 32 bits. That's how most computers deal with it anyway. Here's the idea. Instead of using the entire 32 bits to represent one number, we're going to break up these bits into three parts. And they're going to represent three different numbers in essentially a mathematical equation that we can eventually evaluate. You see, the ingenious way in which a floating point number makes use of its 32 bits is the first bit represents a sign, just like in a signed number. The next 8 bits represent this thing called an exponent, while the remainder is this thing called a mantissa. We use these three numbers in an equation like this. Of course, the sign simply determines whether, well, we're going to have a positive or negative number. The mantissa refers to the body of the number itself, and the exponent is used as a 2 to a power of something. What's really cool about this is that, well, no matter what the mantissa is, you can play with the exponent and get a very small number or a very big number. That's why it's called a floating point. It doesn't have a fixed decimal point somewhere within the bit string. Instead, it uses the exponent, allowing you to shift the decimal points to, well, basically anywhere. And that's the power. Now, that in a nutshell is how floating point numbers work, and if you only want a surface understanding, then we can stop here. But not me, because we're going to delve even deeper into this. We're going to construct our own floating point number. This is where things get a little bit mathy and messy at the same time, so, you know, prepare yourselves. How I'm going to do this, right, is I'm going to just fix a number to start off with. I'm not going to tell you what the number is, but I'm going to show you the 32-bit bit string. It looks like this, and I've already separated the sign, exponent, and mantissa parts. So yeah, we already have three parts. Let's now try and figure out how each part actually works. The sign is the easiest part. If that bit is 0, the number is positive. If that bit is 1, the number is negative. Done. One third of the problem, clear. Let's move on to the exponent. Now, the exponent is interesting because how you read it off is just like any old unsigned 8-bit number. So let's go ahead and read it out. As you can see, if we were to use all our powers, do our usual math, we get a number. Now, that's a huge number for an exponent, and there's a reason why that is. Don't forget, that is an unsigned number. But while we're dealing with floating point numbers, we will want negative exponents to make small numbers. How they deal with this problem, how they reintroduce sign back into the equation, is that the number is being offset. In fact, the actual number is the value you get, minus 127. What this means is, if you see that number as 0, then the actual exponent represented there is negative 127. If you see 128, the actual exponent is 1. Hopefully that makes sense to you. We've offset that number so that you can represent positive and negative numbers. You just gotta do a bit of math to recover the actual number you're supposed to have. So exponent, done. Let's now move on to our mantissa, our largest part consisting of 23 bits. Here's how our mantissa works. If you cast your mind back to fixed point numbers, well, our mantissa works the same way. So to the power of minus 1, to the power of minus 2, it's all negative powers, starting from negative 1. So yeah, it's basically our usual bit math again, but this time, we need to introduce one more thing, and that's our 2 to the power of 0. As it turns out, while there is no bit for it, it is on by default. Therefore, no matter what the rest of the mantissa says, we always add 1 to it. Now, how I'm going to approach the next step is I'm going to convert all those numbers into fractions. The reason why I convert them into fractions is because I don't want to do decimal math just yet. Remember, we're discussing how decimals work, right? We don't have decimals to do that. So we'll leave everything as fractions. And what this allows us to do is to plug these fractions in to our final equation. Remember our final equation, right? We've got our sign, we've got our 2 to the power of the exponent that we've calculated, we've got our mantissa, and we need to multiply everything together. Again, I'm going to do this in terms of fractions until the very end. Essentially, once we solve this part, we end up with one single gigantic fraction that looks like this. Since we have one fraction, that's essentially a division, which allows us to derive our final value, and that is this decimal value. What we've done is we've just worked our way from the binary representation all the way down back to the original decimal. That bit string up there gives us this decimal value. So that's pretty cool. We've just cracked a floating point number. Of course, we can do the reverse, and I'm going to go a little bit faster through that because it's a lot of divisions. But yeah, the way in which we turn a decimal number into a bit string is also fairly straightforward. If converting from binary to decimal is repeated multiplication, as in the powers of 2, then converting backwards to binary is repeated division. For this part, we'll start by taking the integer portion and just repeatedly dividing it by 2. Each time we divide, we are more concerned about the remainder than the actual result of the division. In this case, 17 divided by 2 gives us a remainder of 1. We proceed on with the quotient 8, and we basically repeat this procedure. If we keep going, we'll end up with a set of remainders that can only be either 0 or 1. We'll have to keep going until we stop at 0. Now, it happens that for this particular example, this bit string can be read in whichever direction and it looks the same, but strictly speaking, you're gonna need to read this upwards. The order is important, you gotta start at the bottom. Anyway, this is our integer portion done. Let's move on to the decimal portion. Now, because we are now dealing with negative powers of 2, we are again doing the inverse. So how this is done is we are essentially doing doubles each time. Doubling the number gives us, well, another number, and essentially our result for that part, our remainder, so to speak, checks the integer portion of this number. If it's 0, then the result is 0, and we simply carry on. Rinse and repeat, and essentially what happens is, well, in this case, we'll end up at a value that is 1 or greater. When you get that, the bit being reflected here will become 1, and we'll subtract 1 from this before carrying on. It happens that in this case, because it's perfectly 1, after the subtraction we get 0, so we stop. If it's not, then you have to continue the process. Now, in this case, because this example is fairly simplistic, we're done. For the decimal portion, we read off the bits from top to bottom. Now, as mentioned, this is an extremely simple case, but there may be some decimal values that keep on going non-stop. In this case, we use 0.7, and as you can see, no matter what you do, you will never end up at 1. If you get a value that's say 1.6, right, you'll take out the 1, you'll continue on with 0.6, and as it turns out, this never ends. We know this for sure because, well, we have a point that leads us back to essentially the same thing. It's a pattern that repeats itself. This tells us for sure that this particular sequence will go on forever. There are two ways in which we can stop this process, either when we recognize a repetition like this, or when we have enough bits to work with. Since our Mantissa has a limited length, we don't have to keep on going. Once we have enough bits, that's that. So, what we essentially have now is one bit string for the integer portion and one bit string for the decimal portion. Essentially, we have a fixed point number if we were to assemble these two parts together. So yeah, if we were dealing with fixed point, we could stop here. But what we're doing here is floating point, so we have to fit everything into the mold of sine, Mantissa, and exponent. Let's start by figuring out the exponent. Now, essentially, what we have right now can be expressed as multiplied by 2 to the power of 0. This of course just means 1, right, and the whole thing just doesn't change. But what we can do is we can shift the decimal point. Every shift to the left increases the exponent by 1. Every shift to the right decreases the exponent. Now, in this case, because the number is, well, quite large, we are shifting to the left. And our goal is to keep on doing this until our decimal point ends up here. Essentially, we want to stop when there is only one 1 before the decimal point. This, by the way, is why we always assume there is a 1. If it was 0, then we could stop at a different place and express that with a different exponent. What this means is we technically already have everything. Of course, we know the sign, right? We can figure that out by just inspecting the original number, but we also know the Mantissa. It's basically everything that comes after the decimal point. And our exponent is simply the power up here. Of course, we need to do one more step with the exponent, right? Remember, our exponent is offset, so we need to add 127 to this number, giving us 131, which we can then convert back to binary. So again, we're doing that multiple division thing, right? I won't go through the steps with you again, it's the same set of steps. At the end of the day, 131 gives us this bit string. That is our exponent. Since we now have all three parts, we can now assemble everything together, starting with the sign, which is of course 0. The exponent which we've just calculated with the value of 131, and finally our Mantissa. Of course, this needs to total up to 32 bits, so we simply pad out the rest of the Mantissa with zeros. So these continue to represent the rest of your negative powers of 2, but we don't need them, we don't use them, so yeah, we just leave them as 0. And that's basically it. What we have here is the same bit string that we used earlier to get the value 17.125. So there you have it. That is your floating point number. Now, we've only discussed 32-bit floating point numbers today, but the logic works the same if you're dealing with a double. A double is a floating point number in 64 bits. In two words, it's double, right? We use double the space so we get better precision. The sign bit remains 1 bit, we've got a few more exponent bits, and a whole lot more Mantissa bits. What this means, of course, is that, well, the whole discarding thing happens much later down the line, and as a result of that, we can have much better decimal values. That's why usually we like doubles, right? Because, yeah, there tends to be less problems with that, assuming, of course, your system supports it and is able to do it quick. So yeah, that's it. That's floating point numbers. If you want to play with floating point numbers, if you want to see the working and the math, I have set up a little program to do this on the website. So yeah, go ahead and click the link on screen or in the video description and, well, play with it. Have fun with it. Take a look at how the decimal numbers are being broken down. Anyway, that's all there is for this particular episode. I hope you found it useful. But until next time, you're watching 0612TV with NERDfirst.net. Thank you very much for watching. If you like my work and are feeling generous, you can shoot me a one-time donation on PayPal or sign up for a recurring one on Patreon. Of course, you can simply like, comment, and subscribe. You know the deal. For more videos, links to my channel and a related playlist are on screen. Thank you for your support.